Hi all, and welcome. This video is mainly going to be based in Perth, Australia, although we will venture out of Perth occasionally. So this is Perth over here in Western Australia, right on the west side of Australia. This is Kings Park, and the main city area is here, and we will be looking at this area here as well. So we're just going to now go down to this area here, which is the Burswood Entertainment Centre, although it's about to be called the Crown Perth from July 2012. So we can perhaps see some geometry happening here, so let's fill in some dots, if you will. So we have what is perhaps the compass and square. There's a nice little pyramid up on here as well. And we have the dome over here as well. So we've got a couple more tangents that perhaps line up here as well, emanating from the centre of the dome as part of the complex. Now this is you can have concerts here and sports games and these types of things. And evidently, I don't know if it still is, but it was one of the largest venues of its kind in the Southern Hemisphere, I believe. So just putting some extra motifs in there, crosses. Now, within the Burswood Entertainment Complex, we have a bar or nightclub called Eve, and out of that we have an angel, and we have that the V as well. Perhaps not quite so prominent in that case, but we often have a prominent V, as I often point out. Now, this is a chalkboard. I took a photograph of this chalkboard in the Masonic Centre in Sydney, and I just want to quickly read through it. In the world of sacred symbols, they come from other dimensions, always visible in the worldly life. Since the farthest times, they represent the universal code to read reality beyond the appearance, the magic key to unlock the mystery of existence, and the bridge of light to reach who you really are. The words I want to focus on for this video are dimensions, to keep that in mind, magic. Okay, I want to focus on the idea of magic and take it seriously. So, Manly P. Hall, he talks about, when he was alive, he was a 33rd degree Mason, and he often talks about other dimensions, and he talks about knowing that they exist. He's a 33rd degree Mason, and he talks about knowing that other dimensions exist.
The ancients had one up on us. They recognized that there was something we didn't see, that we couldn't see under normal conditions, and that the visible universe is only a manifestation or a tail-end appendage of something infinitely greater. Now, this infinitely greater has up to now defied scientific investigation, although every once in a while somebody lifts a corner of the mystery, takes a quick look, and drops the corner again. We do not know exactly what is out there, but it is becoming more evident that there is something beyond what we can see. If there is something that we can't see, then we are not in the condition to come to final estimations of the world is in which we live. If we cannot see beyond the physical, and there is something beyond the physical, it becomes more or less probable that whatever that is that we don't see is the cause of that which we do see. This is an irritating thought, but still you can't completely disregard it. So we come to the idea that the ancients had, and we had ourselves down to the time of Copernicus and Galileo, that the physical universe was only a small part of creation, that the rest of it was just as real, but not within the range of our sensory perceptions under normal conditions. Occasionally, someone with an extra sense has brought back information of great interest, but it wasn't possible to settle it down into science because it was another dimension and would not fit into the two-dimensional world of modern physical research.
So let's proceed on. We have the Bell Tower, which is located here. So we're just going to go down now and have a look at the bell tower. So this is it here, and we'll go in for a closer look. So we have what is perhaps here the shaft, the penile shaft, the phallus of Osiris, and we have the waters here, the female waters. This is perhaps the labia majora, and this is perhaps the labia minora of Isis, or a representation of the old Egyptian legend. All right. This is the bell tower, so within here we have the bells, which we will talk a little bit more about. So looking down on it, on the area here, we perhaps have some geometry happening here as well. And there we go, with a 60 degree and perhaps a 90 degree square in here. Perhaps representative, of course, of the square and compass, the Masonic square and compass. We have a sun dial here. So we'll have a closer look at that. And there is a look down on it. And there are perhaps moons there as well, perhaps reminding us of not only astrology in the sense of the sun moving through the houses of the zodiac, etc., but also the moon and the astrology of the moon. Mark Tessarian is one for reminding us of this, and also celestial astrology as well, going sort of beyond that. If we go back to that image there, we have that is perhaps a little moon there. I'm not in Perth to sort of check these things out for myself, so I just rely on photographs and bits and pieces. So we're now looking down on that bell tower once again. And we have this bell motif in the ground here. If we look back, it's right there. So we have that bell motif. Now, if we have a closer look at that, there is perhaps some geometry happening there as well with the 90 degree and the 60 degrees there within that logo. So there is a bell within the Masonic Centre in Sydney. We can see the male sign there with the compass and the female sign there with the square. And right in the middle we have the bell here. Now the bell makes a sound. It perhaps makes a harmonic, if you will. Okay, sound and harmonic. Now, the bells in the tower in Perth are located at 23.5 degrees up from the ground. Now, just to backtrack a little, the 12 of the bells were brought across from England. The ones that were in England, in their location in the cathedral in England, were located 23.5 degrees above the ground in London there. So they've done the same in Perth. They've also added another 6 bells from Australia. This actually makes it one of the largest instruments in the world, evidently. So what it creates is a harmonic sound. So it is perhaps representative of sound. And of course, here we go with the world on its axial tilt of 23.5 degrees. This does vary. It varies from somewhere between around 22.5 to 24.5. But for the most part, it's represented by 23.5 degrees. And this is a photo by Gary Osborne, a drawing. And he claims that the 23.5 degree angle is represented in the Great Pyramid there. I just thought I'd put that in as well. And there are other paintings and bits and pieces that he brings one's attention to regarding the 23.5 degree angle. So I've now included these parts here. If we look here, we have what is perhaps a representation of the moon. And here we have what is perhaps a representation of the sun. There is a cross going through here. It's not so easy to see, but it's there. And I'm suspecting that this, in this case, is representative of the sun. And we perhaps have this middle part here going through with the Vesica Pisces. So there are perhaps, now, this is, may seem like a bit of a stretch, but pillars sort of going through here, if you will, although they're not there, but anyway. So here is Judiciary Square in Washington, D.C., and we have what are perhaps the pillars on either side of the Vesica Pisces design. So you can probably see what I'm getting at there. And here we have the sort of Vesica Pisces design in the middle here, perhaps a gate, if you will, too. Okay, here we have this lady, this goddess coming through that gate. We also have a sort of entranceway here as well on this motif over here. Here we have the moon, and here we have the sun. Sun and the moon. Moving on. Around the area, we also have this concept here with the moon and the sun repeated down here. So we'll have a closer look at this, and we also have representation here of what is perhaps the sun or the earth. So we'll just have a closer look at these. So there's our first one. That's actually a person sitting there. This is a bit of a rise. This design here does change. So this would be a flower bed there, and it does change from time to time. They change these flower beds. So here we have a representation of the moon, and we have this sort of half piece here with this interesting vortex in the middle there. And here we have this motif here as well. And this perhaps is a representation of the sun, solar symbolism in this case, but it is also perhaps a representation of snakes. And from that perspective, I would probably encourage people to go back and have a look at the work of Michael Tessarian, particularly his older stuff on Atlantis. So, and there are these motifs here regarding what is perhaps the sun or the earth. It's very, very difficult at times with the symbology, with just the cross and the circle. There's so many meanings. We're now going to go over to here, and we're going to have a look at this structure here. So it's right still in the same vicinity here. And here we have it. We have a glass house, and we have a Ferris wheel here, and this would be the bell tower right here. Actually, that bell tower, for those who are interested, it sits at 82.5 meters high. I think they originally wanted to make it 81. Anyway, meters high in total. So this is this pyramid here. I'll just read out here. The foundation stone was laid by the then Premier Sir Charles Court, a Freemason. I've checked this, and I verified this for myself in conjunction with Mayor Mr. F. Cheney on the 31st of December 1979. On the 15th of October 1980, Princess Alexandra, daughter of the Duke of Kent, opened the pyramid. Now, the Duke of Kent is a Freemason, from what I know, from what I recall. And I looked up Princess Alexandra, and she was in Alice Springs on the 9th of October in 1980. So I actually assume that this information is correct. I've got it from Alice Taylor, from Alice Taylor's website. Alice Taylor has also done some research on Perth, and when my work sort of coincides with him, I'll bring that up. I'm not plagiarizing his work. So we'll just keep moving on. So if we look on top of this, we have the St. George Cross, and we have the what is perhaps the St. Andrew's Cross under that. So I find it interesting that we have this conjunction of crosses underneath the pyramid. It's a very interesting motif, and certainly there was quite a bit of attention put on it at the time. These days, however, I'm not sure that so much attention is being paid to that pyramid there. Anyway, we have a similar one in Sydney, and once again, it is used for plants, for growing plants in. It's like a glass house there, and there was a show there with orchid sex and death, and I've talked about this before, and there are interesting images that go with it, but that's in Perth there. But we'll move on. This is the Ferris wheel. I think Ferris wheels are interesting. The concept of perhaps an eye of the sun motif. They bring about concepts of the wheel of the flow of astrology and all the rest of it. Here we have Cirque du Soleil, referring to the sun, and we have someone coming in and out of the sun here, perhaps going inside and moving through the sun. A very interesting motif, and just remember that because we're going to talk about that. I'm going to bring that up again, and this is perhaps the surface of the sun, okay? Iris, the eye, sun. Let's keep moving on. Okay, So now we're going to go to this area here, right here. And we're going to go to a place called Jacob's Ladder. First of all, we're just going to have a look down here in this pond just below the ladder. So within this pond, we have the Southern Cross laid out with the seven-pointed star also as represented on the Australian map. So it's just interesting to have this layout sort of laid out, as the saying goes, as above, so below type thing. So we have this motif here laid out within Perth there. Now here is Jacob's Ladder, and we have this is the ladder here, and it goes up this, now goes up up here from this path here and then sort of straight up, and we have these landings here, and I've read that there are 18 landings going up, just as there are 18 bells on that within the tower, within the bell tower. Anyway, let's have a closer look. We're also going to have a look at this building here, and we'll just go through this. This is just a close-up of the landings, and you can see the people, perhaps fitness fanatics going up and down, and tourists. And this is the top landing here of the Jacob's Ladder. So I'll just fill in here. Let's see if I'm just filling in the steps here, or these landings, sorry. So there are perhaps 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 of them from what I can make out. And then at the top, we have this building here, which is an apartment block. And we have this interesting motif coming out here that we see so often, radiating out perhaps like an electromagnetic photon sort of wave, directional wave coming out, if you will. There, this was also divided into sort of 12 parts around the side here, which is perhaps perhaps sort of represents the zodiac in a way as well. And the centre here perhaps represents the sun. Now I know this all sounds quite weird and quite a stretch and all the rest of it, but just bear with me as we go through. Because that's why we're here, eh? We're just looking at possibilities. So that Jacob's Ladder goes up the hill, and well, up the mountain as it is, and this mountain is Mount Eliza, Eliza, El electricity. Okay, remember what I was saying about the sun here, that this is perhaps the sun, the electric sun, if you will. Okay, so this is the picture of it here, looking at the side, sort of an apartment block. The sign here, I think it's 71 Mount Street. We've gone up the ladder to the Eliza, to Mount Eliza and to the sun, okay? We're now here in, this is another Jacob's Ladder, if you will, and we're in the Olympic Park in Homebush in Sydney. Checkered board there, and then we're going to turn around. And again, we see the motif with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 rungs, and then we have the sun. I took the opportunity to put the sun in here at the top, or as best as I could. So here we have two Masonic tracing boards. Now, on this one, we have the ladder here, and we have what are perhaps angels going up and perhaps down the ladder, as per the Bible also, which we will get to. And they're going up to this light here. We have what is perhaps the sun and moon motifs up here as well. Now on this tracing board, they've basically done away with the ladder completely. And this perhaps explains what it really is, and that is a light, a path of light. So, and here again we have more representations of this path of light. But, you know, we've got it in ladder form here again. So, this is an old drawing by Roberto Flood. And we have these 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 rungs. And then we have this part here. this light. Notice that this light, though, is within this part here. Now, I'm going to guess that this darker part here actually represents the sun, and that this part represents the sort of area of the heavens, if you will, the place of where God dwells, etc., etc. Anyway, I'm not going to dwell on that. This is Bath Abbey in England. And there is a Jacob's ladder on the side of the abbey. And we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 angels making their way either up or down this ladder here. And at the top we have this figure here, who I'm going to presume is a likeness of God, if you will. Here we have the chakras, of course, and it should be kind of obvious as to why I've included this in here, okay? The chakras, the seven chakras, the seven orbs, the seven visible orbs in the sky, okay? So this is the hermetic sort of meaning behind all of this. So from the Bible, from the King James Bible, I have some verses here which I'll just read out here. And he dreamed, and behold, a ladder set up on the earth, and the top of it reached to heaven, and behold, the angels of God ascended and descended on it. So that's referring to Jacob's ladder there. And here are a couple of quotes that Bill Donahue perhaps uses, I've just taken out. So, neither shall they say, lo here or lo there, for behold, the kingdom of God is within you. Okay, so this is perhaps within you, the kingdom of God. The light of the body is the eye. If therefore thine eye be single, thy whole body shall be full of light. Okay, so, and once again we have the chakras as well, the chakra system, and we'll carry on. One interesting thing about the Jacob's ladder was, well, I think this is interesting. There's a few things actually. Let's have a look here. It says it has 242 steps. Well, actually it has 243 from what I've read, but the bottom step has perhaps been taken out from asphalt. Now, when it was originally erected a long, long, long time ago, I think it had more steps than this, but anyway. So 243 is perhaps the correct current number. Now, the ladder is a popular site for residents to exercise, with many people using it in the mornings and on lunch breaks. The staircase was closed after being damaged by a landslide during a storm on the 22nd of March 2010. I looked at this and it popped up for me because March the 20th to the 22nd, for me that's the time of the equinox, and that is the time for the northern hemisphere, or perhaps the world, where we see things like the war in Iraq. And on March the 20th of 2003, we saw the war start in Libya on March the 20th in 2011, and as I've pointed out, in 2012 here, that around March the 20th to the 22nd was the release of the movie The Hunger Games, and within that we had the sacrifice of children. And the season of sacrifice, as per Mark Passio, goes from around the equinox, March the 20th to 22nd, from that time to around May the 1st, and it concludes around there. There are other days through the year as well. But anyway, so this staircase was closed, so it was sort of destructed on this at this time, which is quite interesting. And I'm not saying, you know, this is a freakish thing to happen. And then it was reopened on the 21st of June in 2010 after repairs. And of course, this date here is the winter solstice for the southern hemisphere. In the northern hemisphere, the winter solstice is the December the 21st, and we have the resurrection of the entities on December the 25th after 3 days. The timings, I think you can probably see what I'm getting at there, but we'll just move on. So now we're going to look at the Bali Memorial. and it is situated just over here. So we'll just zero down now into the Bali Memorial. Now, this memorial was put there because of the 2002 Bali bombings, what has been described as a terrorist attack in Bali. And I'm not going to go into the detail of that. We're just going to look at symbolism. So this is the memorial here. And we see this motif. Again, we see the circle with these, with this part coming out here, which is perhaps, you know, representative of photon energy, of the electromagnetic energies coming out, and so forth. So here I've drawn in some lines, and we have a what is perhaps a 90 degree line there with a 60 degree line there, making for the square and compass. And you might think this is a bit of a stretch. But maybe it's not. Perhaps these guys don't think it's such a stretch. So this is part of the memorial as well, and we have this handshake going on here. So what is that? Is perhaps a Masonic handshake. Also on the memorial we have the sun here, and we have what is perhaps a pathway going through the sun as well. Very interesting motif there. So perhaps an entry into the sun there and through the sun. There's another shot of the memorial there. That's where the handshake part is there. Okay, so we're over Perth now. We're now going to go down into this part here and have a look at the war memorial and around that area. So that's the war memorial there. Closer look. An obelisk here, and we have the eternal flame just there. So I'm comparing this, obviously, here with the Kabbalah. I've done that in Brisbane with the war memorial in Anzac Square in Brisbane, and I'm doing it here as well. I suspect that this is based on the Kabbalah, even though, of course, you know, there are things different, slightly different. But for the most part, I think you can see what I'm getting at there. So once again, here's just a look at the eternal flame there, the obelisk here. I'm not going to talk about those on this video, but and we're looking over now, and we'll just have a look at some other bits and pieces around here. So there is a clock here, once again reminding us of the importance of timing. And all around here we have motifs which are perhaps reminders of the planet, of the planets and suns, etc. Here we have three pyramids, which are perhaps representative to those in the know of the pyramids on the Giza Plateau. This clock motif is no longer there, I think, because they have rearranged the roads around that area. So things change, but this was in the gardens for a period of time. I'm not sure, it won't be there now, but it's interesting. It kind of looks Stonehenge-ish type thing. I just thought I'd include that in there as I was going through bits and pieces. So now we're going to have a look at an alignment, perhaps. So we do see this line through here. We have an alignment sort of going through there. Obviously, that's quite purposeful. There's a circle in there as well. There's lots of sort of circles representing the orbs, I would say, around here. So here's a closer look, and we have the logo for the park here, the King's Park, and going through here. And now I'm going to, so I've drawn a line in, and this line comes out down here, as you can see, and we'll now have a look at that compared with this angle here. Now this angle is 19.5 degrees. So those who follow particularly the work of Richard Hoagland will remember this number. So that's it there. It seems to sit exactly on that line. One thing about Google Maps is that they're not 100% accurate, in my opinion, because you see things on slightly different angles and so forth. But from what I can see there, it matches. This line here does match up with that 19.5 degree angle. So there it is there, with the with these triangles of 60 degrees, the 60 degrees lined up. on here, and we have this 19.5, they come out at 19.5. Well, actually, it's 19.47 from the equator, but 19.5 is close enough. And once again, it's worth looking at Richard Hoagland's work in regard to that. So just moving on here, do you see any weird features in the garden here? Does anything stick out? When I was looking at it, I was just very curious about this line here and what's happening with this line. So let's have a closer look at that. So let's zero in here on King's Park on this pond. And there is a fountain here. So what we'll do, let's start a line from that fountain. We'll now zero back out and we'll follow this line here in the park. So we'll just move across this way and we will zero in and you should be familiar now with this place here that we're zeroing in on. But we're just going to focus now on the Burswood Dome. So we'll just get in a bit closer. And I'm just going to put this line here, pretty much in the middle of the dome there. All right, now I'll just finish that line off. And we're just going to have a look now and see where that line lines up. So we're now going down into King's Park once again, and we're going down to what is a DNA tower, and you can see it there. So there it is there. So this is the DNA tower, and as you can see, it lines up here with this line from that fountain to the dome, to the Burswood Dome. So of course, I don't know whether that alignment is intentional or not, and I'll leave that up to you to decide. But let's have a close look at this DNA tower. It has the two strands going up here, the double helix. In the middle here we have six supports running up the center as well. Just reading about the tower, built on the highest point of the park in 1966, the DNA tower is a white 15 meter high double helix staircase that has 101 steps and was inspired by a double staircase in the Chateau de Blois in France, and that's the chateau there with the double helix stairway in there. So the design resembles the deoxyribonucleic acid molecule. The paving below the DNA tower is made with stones sent from 11 towns and 80 shires in Western Australia. So that there are these stones there from 11. Don't the Freemasons love the number 11? So there it is, and we'll talk a little bit more about this. So I've just brought up a few images here, and I want to bring up the notion of triple DNA. So there are writings about it, and as we can see here, this is a double helix, and within that we have what is perhaps room for a third helix. Now if we look at the work of Lloyd Pye and Michael Tesarian, they talk about genetic manipulation. So what I'm doing here is just bringing up the notion that that humans perhaps once had three strands or three helixes of DNA, triple-stranded DNA, if you will. And that also, it's Michael Tesarian who mentions that within the middle of the caduceus here, if you will, there is a staff. Now these can also be used as weapons, And anyway, that is perhaps, there is perhaps something behind this. At the Winter Olympic Games in Salt Lake in 2002, Utah, famous for the Mormons, and also the place was perhaps set up by Freemasons. So as part of the Olympic torch ceremony, we have this triple-stranded a tower going up with three strands of what is perhaps DNA. Even the motif in here is similar to DNA. So anyway, it's quite interesting, and I find it quite an interesting notion. So just moving on from that. Oh, actually, with the another thing with the on the subject of triple-stranded DNA, there's a guy by the name of Mike Hoggart. He's a Christian guy, and he's talking about it in Morals and Dogma by Albert Pike. He talks about the Masonic initiate getting a rope put around their head when they're being hung, and that rope has three strands, and those three strands, they are sort of knitted into three. So there's three strands within the first part, and then there are three outer, so it's three times three, if you know what I mean there. So once again, that perhaps is also that alludes to triple DNA. Okay, this is the Firefighters Memorial, and as we're going to see, this is right beside that DNA pyramid. And one thing about this is that we have these stones here, so let's have a look at some more views. We're just having a closer look. So here we go. There's the DNA tower, and we have these stones here, and it's all sort of aligned up, reminding us of alignments, I would say. And perhaps this is aligned up with the rising of a certain star or something like that, or a constellation. Now, talking about alignments, we're now looking at a plinth that is up on top of the DNA tower. And we have our directions on here: north, west, east, and south. And here we have directions that people can look towards, and there are various things like here. It's got Memorial Hospital and Subiaco Oval, various things around Perth that people can look at: Fremantle Harbour, Pelican Point, these sorts of things. But I'm going to suggest that there's more to this than that, and that the north, south, west, and east has a sort of esoteric meaning behind it as well. And it's on this DNA tower here. This is the Angel of the North, and it was created by a guy by the name of Anthony Gormley, and is located at Gateshead in England, and it's located up here in the northern part of England. Now, this thing weighs about 200 tons. It's a monstrous thing. And just the name of it, the Angel of the North, okay? So what I'm suggesting here, that this is an entity of the North, or from the North, an angel. We have a representation of it in Canberra. And so this is in Canberra, and it is within the triangle. It is positioned within the parliamentary triangle in Canberra. So there it is there. It's number four from an edition of five. So now we're going to have a look at this guy here. And his name is Riff Raff, and he is from the Rocky Horror Picture Show. Notice that we have the electricity here. So he is representative of electricity. And here we can see him on this concept drawing. He's almost at one with this electrical current here. So he is Riff Raff, and he is one of the characters in the show. And here is his sister and his lover. Now, this is a reminder of Osiris and Isis, where they had the same situation. But guess what? His sister and lover's name is, remembering that we have a man here representative of electricity. So you have perhaps guessed that Well, if you guessed Mary Magdalene, you were pretty close. So her name is Magenta. Okay, so she is representative of magnetism. In this shot here of the statue, now this statue is located in Hamilton in New Zealand. In this close-up of the statue here, we can see this three-pronged, these things are known as tridents perhaps, but I'm going to call it a fork. And there are various things that you can do with forks. So anyway, he carries around a fork, which is, and that fork is perhaps representative of him in a way. So here we have some entities. Now these are perhaps, as it says here, demonic angels or angelic demons. And this was at a show in Melbourne. And whilst I was having a look at these, I noticed a couple of things. First of all, I noticed the colours here. We have white, whitish colour, red, and then the black. And these stand out for me. But I also noticed up here in the background, because I was in Melbourne recently, I noticed the structure here. And that is part of the Arts Centre. So we'll just carry on here and have a look at some further concepts. So this is the Arts Centre here, and this is a photograph of mine. And we're just going to carry on and have a look at some further. So what I noticed when I was under the skirting of this Arts Centre, that you can see the hexagonal shapes in here. Now these hexagonal shapes are also present in the Masonic Centre on Goulburn Street in Sydney as well. And you can see that there's sort of these rods in here sort of go down to these like cone shapes, if you will. And we have it here, this sort of harmonic coming out of here. Now this is perhaps what I'm suggesting here is that this is perhaps representative of an electric grid or an electromagnetic grid, if you will, grid pattern, grid harmonic. Okay. Here we have a snowflake. Now, of course, these build out from ice particles, which have a hexagonal shape, so they end up being. But it's interesting that they still have the harmonic of the hexagonal shape. And here we have the this is the North Pole, what is perhaps the cloud formation, hexagonal cloud formation on the North Pole of Saturn, which is very interesting as well. So just some further hexagonal harmonics happening there. So we're still outside the Arts Centre in Melbourne, and we have this trio here. I'm just going to add a few extra photographs in. We have the female, the male, and the sun, which is perhaps representative of the Trinity. Further, I took a photograph whilst I was there of this drinks cabinet, because it had the Mount Franklin drink bottle on here as light. And then sort of emanating out of that, it has drink positive. So this is a drink positive, think positive, of course. So this is speaking about intention, okay, intention. And this is part of the mix that I'm throwing in here, because intention is important when we're talking about magic. Now, here we have a monarch butterfly also in that label, and they also include the Vesica Pisces at times as well. Also, you'll see that we're still outside the Arts Centre here. Whilst I was there, there was this show happening, and I just want to show this for a moment. We have the pillars here, the pillars, and here we have more pillars, but these are people. Now, this is a great representation of people as pillars, and we'll just go in for a closer look. Here is another view, and you can see the people as pillars, and there's the art canopy up there of the Art Centre. This man here is perhaps a representation of the green man, the pagan green man, and we have your male and female representations here. We have crystals, jewels, and these pillars, vortex sort of spirals up above. Interesting motifs, I think. Right beside this, I'm now standing on basically on that sort of showpiece there that I was just showing, and right beside this, in front of the Victorian Arts Centre here, we have this Fibonacci spiral, which I'll just include in here as well. So this is perhaps a veneration of nature, I would say. Okay, and you see this within nature. So once again, the natural harmonics being included into the art around Melbourne in this case. Here's another shot of it, and we're just going to go up now and we're going to have a look at this area up here. So this is the National Gallery of Victoria, there you go. And we're just outside the front now, and we can see these two advertisements here, and we will have a look inside. First of all, actually, we're going to have a look up here, and what I'm also suggesting is that this has a Stargate feel to it, as we have water running down here. I've included this part here. I have a feeling that this relates to this sort of Stargate motif. This reads Masonic Temple here, and there's the Stargate motif up here as well. In the background, we have a planet and perhaps a moon type motif. Anyway, we're going to have a look at this plaque now up here. So here is a closer view of it, and we'll take a closer view still. This is a very odd character up here. So we have this odd character up here holding this crown, which is very interesting. Now, speaking about odd characters, we have one in Sydney. This here, I just thought I'd throw this in. It's just interesting to look at. But anyway, just thought I'd throw that in. So we're back at the art gallery, and we're looking from the inside out, and we have these four characters here, and I'm suggesting that they have perhaps walked through, symbolically, through this watery Stargate here. And here is another shot there. So we have that watery background, and that's just putting the suggestion out there in this case, that there is perhaps an occult sort of a meaning behind that. So we're going to, I'm just, from this aerial shot, I'll just point out a few things. We're going to have a look at a little statue here, and right here we're looking down on this art centre, and we're seeing the a combination of the two crosses there again, so the two conjoining crosses. And we have the energy coming down here, the energies, and perhaps dissipating here with an electromagnetic outlay of energy, if you will. We have this triangle here, this triangular-shaped building. Sure, that it, you know, it sort of fits nicely into the way the streets run and all the rest of it, but at the same time, it seems to be an equilateral triangle, and we'll take a closer look at these things. So there we go, there's that roof, there's a closer look at that. We also have that Fibonacci spiral just there. That's where that show is, just there. Okay. This is the roof there. We have this bit of a motif going around here. In this case, it makes for a bit of a sort of a cut-off triangle, if you will, at the top there. But anyway, I'm not going to make too much out of that. So this is that sculpture that's nearby, and this is by Tom Bass, and we'll just have a quick look at this. It's titled The Genie, okay? So where do genies come from? Genie, genius, information. And we have these spirals all over it, as if perhaps it maybe came from these spirals, perhaps. And this is the tail. And the tail is spiraled as if it perhaps came out of a vortex type thing. So genies, they grant wishes. Anyway, let's just carry on. So these colours, I mentioned before that I was interested in the colours. We have the white, perhaps the red and the black. And the royals often use those colours or wear those colours. It's just interesting that we have the motif here and we have the motif here. Now, to be fair, the royals don't just wear those colours, they wear all sorts of colours, but still, I'm just putting this out there. Once again, we have the sculptures here, we have the royals here, Prince William, Prince Harry. Now, over here we have an old album cover by Marvin Gaye. And where do I start with this? There's so much. Here we have that monarch butterfly, and it's over towards the more saintly side here, the sort of good angel, if you want. We have Marvin Gaye there. And then across the chequered table here, we have the more nefarious angel here, the dark angel, with the black, the red, and the white. So you can see the colours there, okay? And we have destruction down here of New York City, the Statue of Liberty blowing up, and there are many other motifs here. We have destruction with water, destruction with fire, perhaps representative of ages, and so forth. We have flying ships, UFOs there, and so forth. The dove on this side, a bat on this side, a serpent on this side, the monarch butterfly on this side, so forth and so forth. There's a lot there, but we'll just carry on now. So we're back at Perth. This is our alignment here, and we're going to have a closer look at this. So we are now over the Burswood Dome, and we'll just have a look at some extra parts here. So I've drawn in some lines here. You can draw in the many crosses, and this would be the Maltese cross. And further lines there again. A comparison here with the compass and square configuration. And a comparison here with the crown. Because this place is going to be called the Crown Perth, it's quite interesting. We have this line up and that DNA sort of lines up here as well. And I was just looking at the crosses on here and sort of I drew in this likeliness of that in here. So it's a very curious thing in my mind that we have that sort of line going through and lining these things up. So we're in the Masonic Library here, and this is the Queen. It's just basically to sort of illustrate I don't know who put that up in the library. That's the Masonic Library in Sydney, but perhaps they just love the Queen, and perhaps that has nothing to do with Freemasonry. So I hope you've enjoyed the show. I'll add some extra bits and pieces on the end here. Bye for now. I've drawn in another line here, this red line. I think it's interesting enough to show, so we'll have a look at that line also. As it runs from that fountain across Perth. So we're just going to go into this part here. I zoomed out a bit far there, but and we'll just notice here that it is falling, that line is falling over the bell tower. And if we zoom back out and we head across town to where it ends, we see that there's this golf course here, and it falls pretty much in the middle. There's our other line down below there. So it falls just in the middle of this car park here. And as you can see, this car park has perhaps been designed around the compass. And this part here is perhaps a planet too, giving off light, photons, etc. into the car park here. You might want to ask yourself, is there any real need for a roundabout right there? You know, we're just sort of coming in and out of the car park here. So, yes. So I'll just zoom out of that. I just thought that was worth showing. And there's a bit of perspective there on where we are. And, yeah. So there it goes. Just another interesting line. The first line that I found going from the fountain to the Burswood Dome rises up about 3 to 4 degrees, I think. And I couldn't suss out what exactly it perhaps points to astrologically, if it does at all, but it perhaps points to the time of Easter, or, and I know that is a changeable time, but a line going from west to east, basically if that line was going straight east, it would fall on the equinox, yeah, it possibly falls at the time of Easter. Anyway, just thought I'd add that. Bye for now.